So, good afternoon, everybody. I think that there's a lot of people who is joining us from different parts of the world. So, hello to everybody. The topic for my talk is going to be how to predict interfaces based on well log. And basically, this is going to be So basically, the topic is going to be basically a comparison between how we can perform this classification by using machine learning and also deep learning techniques. Before going into the presentation itself, let me just give some important information about myself. I'm a 27-year-old Ecuadorian petroleum engineer, studying a petroleum geoscience master in the University of Stavanger in Norway. And this project is part of it's being developed as part of my master thesis project. So, yeah. I'm really interested in connecting geoscience within data science, especially in geophysics. So probably for now, I got the chance for joining this and trying to do something related to well logs. But hopefully in the future, I will try to do something related to seismic data as well. So also, Ari Bulaldin is my supervisor, who is a professor of the university and the geophysicist in Equinor. So to whom I would like to express my gratitude for being supportive this during this project. And also I would like to express my gratitude to Mr. Peterson, who is also an employee of Equinor, who has also joined us during this project. So before going into the presentation, let's talk about the motivation. So basically, considering that there is a lot of people who is quite interested in this topic, I think that the motivation for doing this kind of competitions and also a project is due to the reality, the current reality that we are facing these days, which is also challenging for companies, also for people, but it also opened up great opportunities for learning and then trying to contribute to the oil and gas industry and also in the technological evolution. So basically the original objectives for this project were to compare the machine learning versus deep learning algorithms for phases classification problem. And then from that, trying to construct the robust methodology for solving this problem. And also after finishing more or less this kind of study, we decided to add a new goal, which is trying to perform better while classifying similar interfaces. Since according to most of the people who is working on this, we are really facing difficulties while classifying similar interfaces. So basically, this is going to be the agenda for the talk. Since most of the people in this who is attending this webinar is already familiar with the data set, we are skipping the step one, step two, and going straightly into the things that we have done a bit differently. So basically what we have done differently is not really a big deal. Basically, we have developed originally a logistic regression-based model for trying to construct our models. So in here you can see basically we have run the model. And we have tested the accuracy on the test set, and we have also take advantage of this base model for measuring the accuracy of different normalization techniques for selecting the proper one that we were using from now on. So all of these base models were constructed by just only imputing the data by the median, but then later on we realized that probably we could have done something better, and from here we have add something which is a bit interesting, which is basically we have handled the data by using as well machine learning techniques. So as I mentioned before, basically we have already until this part we have already run a bunch of different techniques, and then we got to know which were the most important features for this issue, for this problem, based on different techniques. Let's say, for example, the K-best test, the random forest feature importance, the recursive feature selection, and some others. So basically, we got to know that the gamma ray, the sonic logs, and the porosity and the density logs were the most important while predicting the data. So basically, what we did is basically we created a missing data ranking, which basically is saying how much data we're missing in the data set. As you can see, the data set, most of the from these five logs, most of the missing data is in the DTS, then followed by the porosity, and then followed by the density and the slowness, the compression and the slowness. But the question may be, what is the purpose of this? Basically, the purpose of this is trying to predict the data, the features, by using as much data as possible. So basically, we are predicting first the sonic log, then moving into the porosity, then moving into the density, and finally into the compression and slowness. So basically, for doing this, we have tested two different methods, which is the random forest and also an XGBoosting regression models. And basically, you can see in the table how they perform. So we split the original training set in two subsets, which is the training and validation set. And we use the root mean square error for trying to see which was performing better in the validation set. So this basically helped us to decide which was doing better. And from this, we decided to select the ones that were giving us the best results according to the validation set. So as you can see, in some cases, we use for predicting these features, the XGBoosting method. For others, we use the random forest. So basically, it's going to be easier if you can see here in a way of a cartoon. So basically, as you can see here, in the first track, you can see the original or the actual or the raw data that we had in red, then follow with the prediction that we got by using either the random forest or also the XGBoosting method, and then followed by something that we call the LCOM, which is basically the log, the combination of both. So basically, we are keeping the actual measurements for the places that they were present, and basically then we are filling those gaps or the empty spaces by filling the data by the predicted log. So basically we follow this process for the DTS, for the porosity, the density, and the compression and slowness, and then we tested again our base model to see if we got some improvements or not. And as you can see here, so basically when we try by imputing by the median, we got the best model by using the standardization method, we got 70%. By when we included or somehow we improved the features in these four features, we got an important accuracy improvement of 2% at least. So basically this somehow encourages to try the same methodology for some other methods, as you can see. But before that, we also decided to include some other features that you can see here. So basically, the process that we are following is we are fixing the features and the most important logs, and we are also adding some important features that we consider that also help to improve, in a way, the accuracy. As you can see, the cluster, the bulk modulus, the shear modulus, the MDT-TBD ratio, the slowness ratio, the acoustic impedance, and the P impedance. And from here, we have decided again to construct the base model for all the models that we were testing. And here you can see that we have tested a bunch of models, the random forest, K-nearest neighbor classifier, precision tree, support vector machines, gradient boosting, XGB, neural networks, and also logistic regression. But due to the nature of this presentation, we have decided to only present the details of the most important ones, or at least for the ones that we have gotten so far, better results. So basically, we're moving into the first one, which is going to be the XGBoosting method that you can see here. So basically, by doing this process, which we're basically predicting the data, imputing the data by predictions by using machine learning techniques, and then also including new features that I mentioned before, and also after tuning the model, and also by using a K-fold cross-validation, we got an accuracy of 82%, which is quite good in the hidden set. So in here you can see in the matrix confusion, you can basically see that we are having some difficulties when we are predicting the shale sandstones. And also we are having some difficulties when we are predicting the mole and the dolomites, or sometimes the limestones. But as I mentioned before, this is what we are facing now. We are trying to solve, which is basically trying to find the boundary where you can properly classify the sandstones and shales and shale sandstones and so on. So basically, this in here you can also see a bunch of wells that I decided to show, but I will spend some more time later on this when we compare the models. So then the second performing model was the random forest. So again, in here you can see the matrix score, the confusion matrix, sorry, and also the accuracy, which is above 80%. Again, in here you can see that the dolomite, the limestones, and the limestones, were the most difficult to get predicted, and also we are having still confusion with the sandstone shales. So yeah, then we decided to move on to try something which was also good at some point, which is trying a neural network. So basically, we decided to construct a fully connected neural network, which is basically the structure was basically one hidden layer with 32 hidden neurons. Also, the learning rate that we used was 0.001. The optimizer was the Adam optimizer. The batch size was 74, and the validation set that we used for validating the performance was the open set. So basically, the base model that we constructed were just mainly constructed based on random values for the hyperparameters. And considering that normally to optimize these neural networks is really a time-consuming task, we decided to incorporate a kind of Bayesian optimization process, which was done by a really useful library, which is the SK optimization. And by doing this and running the process by 75 times, basically we're running this optimization 75 epochs or iterations, we got to find better hyperparameters that you can see here. The learning rate to 0.001, number of layers is still 1, number of nodes 512, and the activation function is sigmoid. And of course, the training, if you compare the base model with the optimized model, the training set is 81%, the validation set is 77%, and the hidden set accuracy is 78%, which actually is doing quite better in comparison with the base model. So this with regards to the neural network. And then here again, you can see how the neural network perform in a way of a confusion matrix. Again, we are having problems with the model, dolomite, and limestones. And there you can find also the logs, the ones that we have decided to show as samples. Finally, I would like to present the comparison between the models. As you can see in the first track, is the real ethology for the selected wells that I'm showing here, for the open set and also for the hidden set. It would be nice if you put a little bit of attention on the third well, which is basically the 31-10. And you can see in the area where you are finding the tuff or the kind of pink lithology, you can see basically that the XG boosting method, even though it is the best performing method for us, it is still doing not as good as the random forest. And it's also, I think, that the neural network is even doing quite better than the XG boosting in this area. So basically, these kind of observations you can see around many wells, and this opens up some alternatives that we can try and that I would like also to share later. Also, as a conclusion, I would like to say that the top three, that the best models that we find, that we found so far, is the XG boosting, the random forest, the Bayesian optimized neural network, and for the hidden set and also for the open set. So basically, it's keeping the same performance for both the data sets. And later, as a conclusion, I would like to also share something that in this table you can see how this simple exercise of improving the features by predicting by using machine learning improve somehow the hidden set accuracy, and also it somehow maintain the test set accuracy around 80%, 79.4%. So basically, you can see how if you incorporate new features, if you fix the features, and then you tune the model and also use cross k-fold validation, you will find out that the model the model at least some the models that we decided to show, they perform better. But in this case, I'm showing just the energy boosting method for simplifying this and considering the time that we don't have much time here. So after presenting these results, I would like also to share some observations that I would like to share with you that probably will be useful for other people who is trying as well this solve this lithology problem. And as I mentioned before, the main challenge is to show to properly separate or classify lithologies with similar composition. In this case, I'm referring specifically with the shale sandstones and the sandstones and shales, and of course with the limestones and dolomites. And I think that it will be useful or to normalize the gamma ray based on the well locations, because as you can see, you can basically see that there are three different clusters according to the location. And those three clusters, they show different behavior in the gamma ray law, meaning that if you normalize the data as a whole, basically you are missing some important information or maybe somehow you are also helping to confuse the algorithms. So basically it would be useful to try to normalize the data, the gamma ray, based on the cluster or the location of the well. Another important observation is like trying to find new features, like for example the shale index of the shale volume will be also useful if you also cluster those features by the location as well, considering that those features may be based on the gamma ray law. And another important observation would be that considering that we have already selected three different methods, which are the random forest, the XG boosting, and the neural network, which are the top performing methods, we are attempted to try something a bit different, which is the stacking method, which is basically we will try to attempt to stack the best performing methods. And we normally, according to the literature, the accuracy is expected to increase at least to 1-3%. So that's at least the expectation that we will give it a try. And another observation is important to mention is that every estimation or prediction for the lithology that we are doing here is basically done isolatedly. Basically, is done independently from the spatial continuity inherent from the subsurface. So I think that it will be also useful if we try to find a way of constructing a feature to incorporate the spatial continuity between faces as we normally have in the real life. So that will be also useful to try. And finally, the most complicated thing that we can try is to make a quality check of the data set. Since, as you can see again, and here you can see the right predictions and the wrong predictions for the shales, and you can see in the wrong predictions the shales are getting confused with most of the lithologies, but mainly with the shale sandstones. So basically, the question will be, why is this happening? Is this a problem of the data set? Is this a problem of the algorithm? So at an ending point will be to quality check the data set. So that would be my presentation so far. Thank you very much. I would like also to thank to the organizers of this great contest. It's great to have this great opportunity to interact with something that probably we haven't tried before, because I'm also quite new in this area. But it's quite really interesting for me, and I would like to thank also Peter Bormann for allowing me to present my thesis work here. If you have any question or maybe you have any recommendation on how we could improve the results, I'm open up to hear your inquiries. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. That was a very nice talk, I have to say. I enjoyed that. But could you go back a couple of slides maybe? And so what was the highest score you achieved? Did you manage to beat in the end what Ulavala had?
And this in
on
which
the matrix, on the highest matrix score you got from all these models?
Please let me know when my sure stop.
So no, it must be another slide here. So you got a matrix score of 0.44, and the highest score we had in the submission was 0.46. Yeah, so you did actually manage to improve on what was the best score in the competition. Very interesting. I mean, the one thing and when you don't compute all these additional features, so if you leave the location clustering, I always thought it's a good idea because that's how geology works, right? Things done next to each other, similar to each other, typically. But if you would take like the bulk's modulus and all these sort of things out, do you see significant degradation in the score, or are they sort of more marginal?
Yeah, actually, in this table that you can see here, and this table right here, that you see here in the race model, the top model that you see here, basically that's the model how the XG boosting perform by only using the data without creating new features. So basically, that was the model without tuning, and the tuned model was performed by 80% in the height and untested.
Yeah, it's the 3%, but I wonder out of the 3%, like what makes the cut, right? Like, but that's a sort of, do you need to do all of what you have there for the fixed features and the additional features, or is it just the clustering maybe, or the DTC? So the sort of feature importance would be interesting to see one day.
Yeah, of course, it depends on the model, because for different models, the feature importance is quite different. So for example, in here, you can see that the XG boosting, the feature that we have selected are 26, but I guess that the random forest we selected 25. So it depends on the model, but the cluster make a big difference, I guess. But it's, yeah. I would say that is a combination of all the features that we included.
Okay, cool stuff. Are there any questions from the audience here?
Yeah.
No, there doesn't seem to be. It's actually the only model that I've seen so far that takes care of the thin beds. so maybe that's where your additional score comes from. So it'll be interesting to explore.